with your pharmacist and insurance company to secure the extra doses. Make copies of important documents. Keep them on your phone, in the cloud, or on a USB stick. Stay informed. Learn about local hazards. Take courses in CPR and first aid, and sign up for local alert systems. An early warning can give you the time you need to prepare for a fast-moving disaster. Be ready. Learn more at americares.org/sendusin.
The new 1010 WOLB with talk in the day and soul at night. WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
Strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. Yeah. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city.
Okay, we are back every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. NL Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson.
Thank you, Baltimore and Beyond, for joining us during the second hour. I would like to thank Mr. Lawrence Bell, our guest on the first during the first hour, with the information that he brought to us about Baltimore City activists and bike lanes. Once again, I'm Tehma Smith-Wilson. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City, and some of the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. If you need to reach out to us or give us a call, please call me at 667-334-7242. And if you're listening and want to join the conversation and are not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or comment to 667-334-7242. And I also have two opportunities that I would like to share with you. The Huber Community Life Center will be having a college question and answer event. So this is a college question and answer event on Saturday, September the 23rd from 9 o'clock to 1 o'clock. So if you have any children who are in grades 5 through 12, we're trying to prepare them early, please go online and register at www.huberchurch.org/get-ready. www.huberchurch.org/get-ready. If you need more information, please text me and I'll send you the flyer. And also on Saturday, October the 21st, the Huber Community Life Center will also be having a health conference and fair. So that's from 11 to 3 at the Huber Community Life Center. And some of the topics that they will go over are mental and spiritual health, dental hygiene, breast and prostate cancer education, games for family and children, cardio exercises for seniors and dance routines, a family feud competition, and a Ask the Doctor station. This is Saturday, October the 21st from 11 to 3. If you want more information on either one of these events, please text me 667-334-7242 and I will send you the flyers.
And what subject might be on your mind today we get into?
Whatever the callers want to discuss, whether it's more topics or more questions or information or comments about the bike lanes, or we had a meeting with the juvenile, or in Annapolis, there was a juvenile meeting regarding next steps in terms of trying to curb this juvenile violence. Anything you want to discuss? I look forward to it.
Okay. And our other co-host, I call him the Dean, Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
I'm still here, and today is still the first day, or part of the first day of the rest of your life. Use it wisely.
And your number?
410-547-8820.
Did you give your number, Tehma?
Yes, I'll give it again. 667-334-7242.
And Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA, if you need our services, is 410-669-1738. And I, as I announced on the first hour, tomorrow from 11 to 3 at Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, 4016 Park Heights Avenue, will be an entrepreneur day, of which I will be a part of, talking about how to get your affairs in order. Now, a lot of people call me off the air and have called about this. So this is your chance to come and hear, and we'll be able to help you all we can. There are other persons that's on that, and I'll try before we go off to let you know who they are. Also on Sunday is the Patrick Lundy concert at the Mount Moriah Baptist Church in the 2200 block of Garrison Boulevard at 3 o'clock. Given by Mount Moriah, $20 donation. Also, on Monday is the viewing for Miss Mona Lisa Marine. Viewing and services on Monday, September the 18th. The wake is 10. The services are at 11 at the Park Lane Baptist Church, 3606 Mohawk Avenue. And on Wednesday is the viewing, September the 20th, from 4 to 7 at the Park Lane Baptist Church, 3606 Mohawk Avenue, for Mrs. Celestine Knight, very well-known young lady around town who was one of the original Baltimore Fellowship Choir members and also an administrator at the Taxation and Assessments Office down on Utah. And her services are on Thursday, September the 21st, the wake at 10, services at 10:30 at the Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, 4016 Park Heights Avenue, with interment in Druid Ridge Cemetery. Some of the things on my mind before we go to the phone. When we come to the phone, I want to thank Bill Gooden for holding so long. We're coming to Bill, Dwight, Kevin, James, and we got a line open if you want to call in, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. 10-10. Now, one of the things, Tehma, you hit on, and I don't know if this has to do with what you were talking about, but on the front page of The Sun, group slams child law. Maryland prosecutors blast new act that some police aren't following. A bipartisan group of Maryland prosecutors doubled down this week on claims that a new law requiring that underage defendants consult with an attorney about their rights before police can interrogate them is making the public less safe. That's one of the things I'd like to throw out to you and Bob to maybe have some comment on the fact that you are attorneys. The other thing is there was a testimony given the other night by one of the mothers. By one of the mothers whose daughter was a victim in the Brooklyn crime situation. And she gave a testimony on that night, which was so impressive and so moving that they had to stop the hearing. And I'm talking about Miss Crystal Gonzalez, who lost her daughter as a result of that gathering down in Brooklyn. She made some very compelling comments about what she felt happened, the evidence of what she saw happen, want to throw that out there for discussion. Hunter Biden has been indicted. on federal firearm charges.
Woohoo.
But the thing is, a lot of these legal pundits that are talking, saying they've never seen anything like this before on somebody like that who had a drug addiction. So we're wondering, had it been Joe Blow, if would this had happened? Or was this because it was Hunter Biden, the son of President Biden? Water Task Force offers assurances at first meeting, and that's they got a task force of which Bill Henry is heading about these water bills, especially since there are a whole lot of folk in the county whose bills are much less than us in the city, and it's being discussed. And many other things out there. There was a op-ed written the other day on the Washington Post by David Ignatius, who is a well-respected journalist, one of the few journalists that the White House pay attention to, in which he came right out and said what a lot of people were thinking, and that is the fact, should Joe Biden and Kamala Harris be the ones to run up against Trump? And it has caused almost a furor throughout the Democratic circles on because there's a lot of people in the Democratic circles that have been thinking the same thing. However, who has beaten Donald Trump? Mr. Biden has. Has the others been proven? You don't know. Has the others proven on the same situation as with the GOP in? They got folk trying to get in, but yet these folk get on stage in a debate, and when the question is asked, would you support an indicted, in fact, a convicted president, these fools raise their hand, but yet they want to be president. So it's a lot out here that's on the agenda that can be talked about. But, Bill, we're going to come to you real quick because you've been holding so long, and then Bob, I'm going to come to you.
All right.
Bill, you're on air.
Well, first, let me just say thank you and good morning to each one of you. And I went to that task force meeting the other night in reference to the water, so it wasn't about nothing. But I called in to talk about a topic that y'all talked about last week, which I really disagree with, Bob, as well as the other hosts, right? And that's this. When we say, if you say you like Sheila Dixon to be mayor, then that's good. But you say you like her because she have experience, and Bob Wallace don't have no experience in terms of running the city, I don't think that's a fair assessment. And the reason I say that is this, is that number one, a lot of us voted for Westmore. I think Westmore probably doing as good a job as the previous governors. He didn't have experience. He's running the entire state, right? You know, I think that we look in terms of at Bob Wallace in terms of the businesses that he has created, the things that he has done. I think that his resume will be better than a whole lot of other people's resumes. So just to make the comparison, because he hadn't been in office, and we think that a person been in office is going to do better, is ridiculous. That's the same way with Republicans saying they think Donald Trump is going to be better. Now, all these Republicans who've been in office for years and years and years, they'd rather pick a man who don't have no real experience to run the entire country opposed to picking a person with experience. Why is that? Because Donald Trump represents their interest. So I'm just saying that people should vote for who they feel is going to represent their interest, and let's not go by experience, because if we look at that, Bob, if we look at that, Ms. Smith, if we look at that, Carlton, then experienced politicians has helped us to get into the situation that we're in right now. Even with what Lawrence Bell talked about, then experienced politicians has helped to create that situation. So maybe we need somebody that don't have experience in running the government to help us to get out of the situation. What do you think?
Let me respond to that. It's believe it or not, it is much more difficult to run a municipality or a city than it is a state or a country. That's because all politics is local. It's at the city level where you can walk down the street and see the highest ranking officer in the city. It's at the city level where the potholes need to be fixed. It's at the city level where you have to deal directly with the education issues and the crime issues. The farther you are removed from it, the more insulated you can be. The more structure you can put into place to remove you from having to be directly accountable to the people. Now, the fact that let me finish. You asked the question. Let me answer. Okay. I have represented businesses and the city of Baltimore for over 40 years. I know how the city is actually run. I know where a lot of the bodies are buried. I know that if you don't know those things, it will take you time to learn them. In my opinion, the Baltimore City is in a crisis mode. And I have nothing against Bob Wallace. We've been friends for many years. You've heard him say on this radio, hey, he thought I was, I didn't know I was his mentor. But he's been a friend for many years, and he certainly has achieved the things, many of the things that you have described. But none of those things will impart to him the immediate knowledge that is necessary to know how the inner workings of the city operate. Now, every problem. Every politician that I've known, including my former partner Elijah Cummings, every politician I know has, at one time or another, been motivated primarily by the desire for reelection. That doesn't make any difference who it is, whether it's Robert Wallace or Wes Moore or Sheila Dixon or anybody else. They all want to be reelected, and they all run on the promise that if you reelect me, I can finish the job that I promised to do the first time. Well, we don't have. I don't believe that the citizens. I think the city is in a crisis mode. I think that we need someone who already knows the inner workings of the city, and that's to take nothing against anybody. It's a question of timing. There's a time and place for everything. I just don't think the time is right now. That's all.
Well, and the only thing I'm saying, Rob, is this, and that's a good analysis in terms of what you use. I'm just simply saying we don't know what a person can do until they have that opportunity, number one, right? Number two is that when you talk about running a city or a government, then it depends on who you surround yourself with, who's your staff, who's your advisors, people that you're listening to, people that know how to walk you through the things that you need to walk through to know where the bodies is at, to know where the money is at, to know different things. But we can't say a person can get in there because they don't have that experience and they won't be as good as a previous person. If that's the case, then we could have the argument that we might as well leave Brandon there because Brandon got experience and we could say, well, he's doing a good job. Well, some people going to say he's doing a good job. I'm just simply saying, let's not use experience as the measuring tool for running out.
I didn't say experience. I said knowledge, not experience, knowledge. Knowledge of the inner workings. That people may use the word knowledge and experience interchangeably, but I don't.
Okay, let's go to. Actually, I don't think Brandon has done a good job.
No.
So I'm putting it out there. I don't know why Bill would be talking about. Well, people could. Well, there might be somebody that might say that, but I don't think it's no overall through this city that's going to say that. Dwight, you're on the air. We got a line open, 410-481-1010.
Good morning, entrepreneur Carlton Douglas. Good morning, attorney Dashiell. Good morning, attorney Smith. God bless y'all. Very good show this morning. And my boy Bell got on. He made some good points about, because I used to live on 3122 going for a Parkway. But I'm not going to go back into that because y'all on different subjects now. But it's not no room up there for no bike lane, sir. It really isn't. I was up there the other day, and it was everybody has to get over into that one lane, and then they want to widen the lane and put bike lanes. Then the people ain't going to have nowhere to park on.
Yeah.
And not.
You're right.
I used to live there for years. I was raised there by Charlie Rice, his brother. Remember Charles Rice?
Yeah. I was a pallbearer for Mr. Rice. Yeah, I know.
You didn't know that was my uncle, though.
No, I didn't.
But, very good subjects. Y'all have a good weekend.
Okay.
And, I got a text this morning, Carlton, from somebody on the choir said we're supposed to sing up Oscar Brown's church at 7:30 tonight. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Dated at 6:51 this morning, so I just got the message because I thought we were supposed to sing at the American Festival, African American Festival. But it's at Oscar Brown Church tonight. So okay. I hope to see you, man. All right. All right.
Tehma.
I got a message from the text line regarding Mr. Lawrence Bell.
Mm-hmm.
It says, I don't feel sorry for black folks in Baltimore City because we had a chance to elect a conscious black man like Lawrence Bell, but listen to Senator Rollins or on Pastor Reverend Reed, therefore electing Martin O'Malley that has set this city back 20 years.
You know, Bob, and I want to thank you, Bob, again on these airwaves for coming on my other show on Wednesday. You were a fantastic. My listeners really enjoyed you, and of course, we'll have you back. But you touched on something that day about that situation with Pete Rollins. And then tell our listening audience what you reiterated about what went down with that situation.
Well, what I was speaking about is that people postulate that in the current situation there might be someone white who might enter the fray. And because of the split vote between Sheila, Bob Wallace, and Brandon, that they might win as the O'Malley did back in those days. But what I was saying is those circumstances, the circumstances that existed then, don't exist today. Right. Martin O'Malley was the beneficiary of an agreement that had been reached between Pete Rollins, who was then the chair of the powerful House Appropriations Committee in the state, agreement between Pete Rollins and Ricky Spector, who was then representing, I think, the 5th Councilmanic District, where if Ricky agreed to take Pete's daughter, Stephanie Rollins Blake, and put her on the ticket so that she eventually became the youngest member of City Council elected, that Pete, in turn, would support O'Malley.
Okay.
Because he wasn't particularly, he never was fond of Lawrence Bell in the first place.
Right.
But so and that's what happened.
Okay.
Pete Rollins put his support behind Martin O'Malley, and that is why Martin O'Malley was successful. And it had nothing to do, it had nothing to do with O'Malley and who he was. I think up to that time, O'Malley was a first-line associate firm in a very small law firm in Baltimore City.
Well, you know, a lot of, and I had to say this, and Lawrence is my friend, but a lot of people also blame Lawrence for taking O'Malley up in the hood in the first place,
yeah.
You know, during that time when he didn't have to. Let's go to Kevin. You're on air. Kevin?
Yeah, I'm here. Lawrence Bell and this bike lane. He's probably a couple of years late. The Lincoln Park situation turns into the bike lanes, okay? Lincoln Park is 1,000 acres. The Department of Interior, which is the people who own Yellowstone Park and Automotive Park, have invested money already. So he's out the way because they want to go right into Lincoln Park. They got an amphitheater there. They got the old Girl Scout thing there. They want to open that park up. They have tens of thousands of people come there camping out and everything else. That's one situation. I want to talk about, I'm sorry for Lawrence Lex situation. I mean, bless his soul, Jack, because we in East Towson and the other communities down there in Turner Station, Captain Harvey, we all remember Mr. Lawrence. I'm hoping that the lawyers that are settling these cases didn't settle for nothing under $1 billion, because Thermo Fisher is a $38 billion company a year. In the last 10 years, they didn't did, just the 10 years, they didn't did $38 billion.
Who's that? Who made that money? What's the name of the company?
Thermo Fisher.
Okay.
Thermo Fisher is a company based out of Massachusetts. That is one of 100 companies that they can sue, and they know that. And I got this other article. I'm not going to tell you how Howard Hughes played in the Henrietta Lacks, because the article's right there. I want to say this about this Brown versus Board, and you all not knowing who Pauline Murray was. Thurgood Marshall went to, I think, the
We know, sir. We know, sir. We know who she is. We discussed it.
I mean, you...
Got to go. We know who Colleen Murray is. Yeah. We discussed it the other week. Let's go to James. James, you're on air.
Yes, good morning, my friends. This is Leo
Oh,
Burr.
It's Leo.
Good morning, Leo.
Okay. Listen, let me say this to you, Carlton. Monday night, the Roots and Scouting Organization meets at 7 o'clock here on McMecken Street. I hope you can attend. We've got more pros and cons to report on, and it is open to the public, and we're going to have something to say about the fire department and the fact that we've just received funding for our rites of passage program for our young people. So we're very proud of that fact. Let me ask the question of you, what kind of punishment is appropriate for the Baltimore City Police Department in light of the after-action report, or I'll call it the after-inaction report, that specifies the indifference of the police department, its malfeasance in office, its depraved indifference, its dereliction of duty, and gross negligence? I want to emphasize that reassigning a major is not all this should be about. This has gone on for much too long. What are we going to demand that the mayor do and the city council do with respect to taking the appropriate disciplinary action and or docking of pay or whatever else? Because I'm just tired of the gamesmanship and the cover-up that's going on in front of our eyes, because the mayor's trying to cover it up and say, well, this is just one of those things. Well, it's not one of those things. It's a continuing scenario of abuse and disrespect for the interests of the citizenry of Baltimore City, and it's time we drop the hammer on somebody's behind.
What would be your suggestion?
Firing some officers and or docking pay and or suspension of officers. I mean, somebody's got to take the fall. They've acknowledged they've been indifferent. I describe the indifference as cultural or racist indifference. They're under a consent decree, and they're not abiding by the mandates laid out before them. What must we do? And must we demand action? Because we're not getting it. We're getting a talk-a-thon, and that's not going to work.
What?
Thank you, Leo. Well, I got a question for the two of y'all. Do you think there's a suit there? Do you think this lady that was so emotional and passionate the other night at the council meeting and the family of the other person that was murdered in that situation and those who were wounded, because of the negligence that the report says the police department had in this situation, is there a suit?
The short answer is no.
Okay.
And there's a couple of reasons for that. One, you've got the concept of sovereign immunity, which basically means the government can't be sued unless the government says it's okay to sue me. The other thing is, I think there have been cases previously decided that established that the police department does not have a specific, that no individual has a right specific to that individual to have the police department do anything as it relates to them. So the police department doesn't have an individualized obligation to a particular citizen under any particular circumstance. So I think there have been cases that have held that. So. Now, the solution, if there is, number one, people need to understand it's not going to happen overnight because the situation didn't happen overnight. And I don't say that to escape it, but it's just not. But it's in this situation, it starts at the top. And also it has to do with the negotiation of the collective bargaining agreement between the city and the police department, which to a large extent shields police officers from being accountable for their conduct. I mean, it's one of the few situations where you can have charges and you stay on the job collecting money pending the outcome of the charge. The citizens still end up paying your salary during that time. And if you're found guilty, you don't have to pay it back. And part of that results from the terms of the collective bargaining agreement that they have. But it starts at the top.
Okay. Yolanda, you on air?
Yes, hi. This is Yolanda. How y'all doing?
Fine.
Good. This Mr. Douglas?
Yes.
Hi, Mr. Douglas. This is Yolanda Pulley. I was calling.
Oh, hi, Yolanda. Okay.
Hi, how are you?
Hi.
I pay attention to words. And when we say certain words, it kind of, you know, put disparage into voters' mindset. We got to be careful of the words that we use, like experience or what's that other one that he used? The inner workings, knowing the inner workings. Knowing the inner workings has gotten you the gun task trace force. Inner workings has gotten us a corrupt government. Inner workings has gotten us a CEO to get paid more than the president of the United States. The inner workings has gotten us a mass shooting and everybody is being ignored. Inner workings has gotten us politics as usual. And those people don't deserve to live like that. And for the young lady who was emotional, her name is Crystal. That was the mother of Aaliyah.
Right, Crystal Gonzalez.
Calais was the guy that was murdered.
Right.
His mother's name is Tamika. Mm-hmm. I know. I'm in touch with both of them, and what happened is what wasn't deserved, and they deserve protection just like Fells Point and any other surrounding community. So Baltimore City is held liable. I mean, they are responsible for what happened, because just because they dropped the ball doesn't mean that they should be getting off with a pass, if you understand what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
They dropped the ball. They left these people vulnerable. Everybody knew. The police department knew about their flyer days before their, social media. They have a social media that was sent to them. They knew about this days before, and they still chose not to protect those people. Why? That's my question. Why? Is it the color of their skin? Is it the way that you're making them live? If it's because it's the project? Is it because they get government funding? They still deserve dignity and respect, and they still deserve to be protected. But my thing is when you're talking about putting somebody back in office or the inner working of city government, you got to realize how you already been sold. They always follow the same blueprint as politicians. None of them deter from that because they know that's where the money is. So we just got to be careful how we speak on these so-called words. Thank you for your time.
Mm-hmm. When I come back to the phone, it's coming in this order. Brown, Don, Vegas, and Haki. But, Bob, I'm gonna get back to a question because you just explained very well, and I'm not challenging anything you just said. But with the situation with Freddie Gray and the police was kind of held responsible.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, Billy got the family $6.5 million. Why do you think Billy was able to do that if he had gone with filing it with the city and to listen to what you were saying, he probably wouldn't have got anything?
One is a action versus an inaction. You know, Freddie Gray, the police officers were charged with something, whether they actually physically harmed him or whether they gave him a rough ride or what have you. It was probably a civil action where, you know, we can't say you did anything specifically, but you are responsible for the totality of a situation. I guess in Brooklyn, the police did not actively injure anyone. There was an inaction on their part. We are blaming them for not doing something, for sitting there or not being there or for not having enough people there. But there's no action that they did. They didn't hit anybody. They didn't run anybody over. They didn't shoot any. There's no action that they did that, you know, you could point to and say, hey, your action caused this. It was an inaction.
Plus, the Freddie Gray settlement was political. There was never a lawsuit filed for Freddie Gray. The Murphy firm never filed the lawsuit. There was never a complaint filed.
Oh, it was just a threat.
It was a threat of a complaint.
Okay.
And Stephanie Rollins Blake, I think, was the mayor at the time of that.
Yes,
of
she
that,
was.
Of that settlement.
Yeah.
And it was settled. And then when they were asked, how do you settle a lawsuit that hasn't been filed? Because of the prospect of it being filed and the prospect of the outcome. That was a political decision.
Okay. All right. Let's go to Brown. You're on air.
Brown from Sandtown.
Yes, sir.
I got a question for attorney.
Which Bob. One? Bob? Okay.
Bob.
All right.
You're representing Oscar Lorenda as their attorney. A company that did not meet the MBE goal at all.
That's not true, but go ahead.
I'm going to tell you. I was with Alan Myers.
Who is it? Who am I talking to?
You're talking Brown for Sandtown, a MBE contractor, a real one that built from the ground up. I protested at the Board of Estimates with Alan Myers over the MBE goal at Ashburton and Drew Hill Park. Alan Myers protested because they superseded the goal by 2%, which was a goal of 20%. Ask Lorinda had 13%. The Board of Estimates shared, because Ask Lorinda is saving the city $50 million underbidding Alan Myers, forget the MBE goal. So people, this is why I'm sharing with you, don't get excited about MBE goals. I'm on both projects. There's local hiring reports for Ashburton Tank and Hilton Reservoir. Oscar Lorinda, owned by Frank, is not hiring anybody for the local hiring reports. 21216, 21217, 21215. Nobody, and I see these young men come up to the job site, suited and booted, ready to work. On the prevailing wage sheet, there's a section that says common labor, no experience, $22 an hour, is not being forced by Oscar Lorinda. They do not care. Now, the question to you, Attorney Wilder, because you're representing them, explain to the people how the local hiring reports work and what must that general contractor do, because the Board of Commissions at 4th Street, before the project was even bid it, sent out the local hiring reports of how many people that each contractor must hire to be on those projects because the money is already allocated for it. Can you explain to us how that works? And then you have a project by Whitey and Turner, you have nothing to do with that, that's at Mondawmin, have a security firm at the gate stopping young men in the community from coming on the job site trying to get hired. What is going on here? Okay. I'm on these projects.
Okay, let him answer.
Please answer us about the local hiring reports. Your client, that is a crook from out of Texas.
Well, let me say first.
Wait a minute. First of all, let's not be calling names here.
Well, that's okay.
Besides that, you might think he is, but on these airways, we ain't calling no names. Go ahead, Bob.
Let me make one minor correction, and then I'll address the substance of what you said. The name of the company is Oscar Renda, and it's owned by Southland Holdings. Now, with the local hiring law has been applied, and it does apply, but it doesn't require that you hire a specific number of people. It only requires that you hire the people as needed. The workforce that Oscar Renda has hired at both sites is over 60% of its workforce. How do I know that personally? Because I have referred people to be hired, and some of the young men have even been hired and gone on to engineering school and other places because of the experience that they were able to gain working there. So I don't know. Let me address this issue of minority contractor participation. Since I'm the one who wrote the law and I'm the founder of the Minority Contractors Association, one of three in Baltimore. So let me tell you about how it works. When you say that Oscar Renda was awarded the contract by the Board of Estimates because his bid was $50 million lower than Alan Myers, that's not a bad thing, because if there was a difference in the schedule of minority participation, it was significantly less than that and was probably achieved even after the contract was awarded. And by the way, the company that you talk about, Alan Myers, I don't want to talk about over the phone, but Alan Myers has a notorious history of underperformance as it relates to minority participation. I can tell from the way you say it that you believe it, but I don't believe you actually have the facts.
Well, I would suggest, Brown, that you call Mr. Dashiell off air and discuss that with him. Let's go to Don. You're on air.
Yeah, thanks for taking my call, Carlton. Peace and blessings to all. First, I want to thank you, Mr. Ball, for closing that gap for me in my mind anyway. I was wondering how Ms. Rawlings, Stephen Rawlings, moved up the ladder so quickly out of nowhere. And you closed that gap for me when you told me about how far that deal you made with Ricky Scruton and things of that nature. Also, how O'Malley got up in there. But he had some powerful hitting. He had Joan Carter backing him up. She had her motivation. And you also have Reverend Reed. We keep forgetting about these things. And some other politicians who backed him and wouldn't back Barrow or Stokes and things of that nature. So back to the... go back to the Ritz Carlton, but thanks for that information anyway. But back to the bike lanes and things of that nature. I always wonder about the bike lane. They're always against the bike lane because I'm wondering, wait a minute, if you ever have a terrible snowstorm, and these one-way lanes that they made into, where are they going to push that snow?
Mm-hmm.
With only one lane.
Yep.
How are they going to put the, where are they going to, say they're going to mess the things they put up in the street and cause more money and things of that nature to put them back in little plastic poles and things of that nature? I mean, it's a disgrace in a whip barrel and everything like that when it comes down to these things like that. That was a disgrace. I get mad every time I go across and see stuff like that. Have a good morning.
Yeah, you're right, Don, because we were lucky this past year because we didn't have any snow. But I can't wait to see what's going to happen if we get a even a small snow. If we get a blizzard, we in real trouble. Tehma?
Yes, this is a text message from one of our listeners saying that he's trying to connect the gaps. He says someone basically is making a lot of money from the bike lanes. Baltimore City has most cities have up to 5 development corporations, Baltimore and Greater Baltimore Committee and Baltimore Development Corporations dominate Baltimore City as a nonprofit, and they privatization used for schools and expenses of students. Special ed, for example, is a way that they make money, and that they have no big contracts but can be used in school constructions. Bottom line is that the people with the power are putting people who look like us in office to help them make more money.
Okay. We're coming to Vegas, Haki, and Bubby. We got 2 lines open. You want to call in 410-481-1010. Well, somebody dropped off there, so we're going to Vegas first. Vegas, you're on air.
Hey, how you doing? Actually, it's not Vegas. It's D. Got it wrong, but that's no problem.
Oh, okay.
But what I wanted to speak on is steel addiction. I think we, you know, this is just my opinion. I think we're making a mistake, or we would make a mistake putting her back in. Sheila Dixon, I believe, is a part of the problem that Baltimore has. She's a part of the problem. And I think Baltimoreans should be smarter than that, than to put somebody back in. I don't believe that Sheila Dixon, go around, she's boasting about how she was very responsible for bringing the crime down. Okay, you can say that she may have been in position when that crime went down. However, Sheila Dixon, the things that police were able to do when Sheila Dixon was in there, they're no longer able to do that kind of stuff. So another thing is that Sheila Dixon, I'm all for giving people a second chance. Okay, Sheila Dixon should have a second chance, just like anybody else should have a second chance, but not a second chance as the mayor. The GTTF should have a second chance, but they should not have a second chance as being at being a police. You understand what I'm saying? So I just don't think that Sheila Dixon is the right person. I don't know why we feel like we have to keep going backwards. I think we everybody gets a first chance at being the mayor. She had a first chance at being the mayor. So it's not like when you come in as being the mayor, you've never been there for the first time. Everybody's got to be there for the first time. So I think we need to really consider or think about putting this woman back in there. She was arrogant. She was more arrogant than the mayor that we have. Okay? So I think we need to.
Well,
really
I have to disagree with you on that one. I majorly disagree with you on that one. But let me ask you a question before we go, because we got some more people on here we got to get to. But if it's not Sheila, then who are you supporting?
Well, I have not decided who I'm going to support, but I am not going backwards.
Okay. All right. Let's go to Bubby. Bubby, you're on air.
Thank you so much for taking my call. I thought I would never say these words. I happen to agree with Attorney Bob Dashiell. And the information he gave out about Pete Rawlins in relationship to how Stephanie Rawlins made her ascension to the leader of this city, I'm very impressed with that information. But let me just say to you, Carlton, and Attorney Dashiell, and the female attorney, Miss Wilson, I believe her name is, I have been trying for over 2 decades to ask the citizens to look at the city agencies, how they're not benefiting city residents. And Attorney Dashiell, I'm so upset with this board stuff, these boards of commissioners. They are not of the people, for the people, and they do nothing. They allow these city agency director heads to totally manipulate something. I am dealing with a case right now with a young man who has over 23 years of experience, 2 decades with the city. He left the city, now he want to come back to work for the city, and he put in an application with the Baltimore City Housing Authority for a laborer. Now, this man had descended as a chief mechanic, a lead mechanic for the Housing Authority. And you know they had to unnerve Attorney Dashiell to send him a letter saying that they are moving forward with another applicant, not him. Now, this is how the city agency retaliate against Baltimore City residents when they speak up about the injustice going on with the city agency. I personally called the Labor Commissioner of Baltimore City office and asked them, could they please look into why this young man is being discriminated against for a city agency when he have all the credentials? I mean, this is shameful what we allow. And let's be honest, this man, Brandon Scott, is a terrible failure to what he done with the citizen. I am not sure who I'm going to vote for, but one thing you can bet, I will be voting and I will donate my pennies to the person that I choose to support. But Carlton, we must look into these city agencies and these boards of commissioners, i.e. school, housing, and other agencies. We got to get rid of these boards. They are not people representing the interests of the citizens of this city. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Okay. Joe, I believe it's, is this Joe?
Hey, good morning, everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to chime in and say, people seem to have forgotten Lawrence Bell and what they did to, and they sabotaged him. That Martin O'Malley thing, well, Martin O'Malley jumped in a race because of Howard Pete Rollins talked him into it, and he knew that the votes would be split because of the fact that he knew most of the white folks were going to vote for Martin O'Malley. Now, if Carl Stokes, as Lawrence tried to ask him, why don't you step out the way and let me battle Lawrence? O'Malley on my own, he wouldn't have had a leg to stand on because the black vote would have went to Lawrence Bell, because then they wouldn't have split the vote because he would have had most of the vote. It wasn't enough white people to put O'Malley in off.
Okay.
That's why
Thank
they
you.
Sabotaged Lawrence Bell.
Thank you. Okay. We got a few minutes here. So, Hunter Biden being indicted, do you think this is going to affect the chances of his father running for president?
Not on the gun charges or the drug charges or the charges that they have against him. I think one charge is for him.
It's no drug charges.
Right,
it's a gun charge.
Right, gun
charges.
So far, it's like two charges. One on the fact that he filled out false information when getting a gun.
Right, getting a gun.
And then the next one is him having a gun as someone who uses drugs. So I don't think his convictions, if he is convicted, or the indictments will have a role on whether or not people decide to vote for his father. However, if they do go and they investigate any business dealings and whatever they might find with that, I think that might be the only thing that might interfere with his father getting reelected, is if they find any business dealings associated with each other.
Now, the serious charge that the Republicans are waiting for is the tax situation. That's where they want some movement to try to tie him in, tie his father in with him to make a big to-do about. What do you think, Bob, about the
First of all, I don't care what happens to Hunter Biden. He's not never been an elected official. He's not president or anything else. And the area that they are hoping to find something involves his business dealings while his father was vice president. I mean, the speculation is that somehow or another, as vice president, that Joe Biden was somehow involved with his son's business activities. They don't know whether any such thing is true, and they don't really care. This is tick for tat.
Right.
You impeached our guys, and the guy leading up. I still want Jim Jordan to tell me what he knows about what happened with the wrestling kids at Ohio State.
And I still want to know about the sexual stuff that Gates been being investigated about. Since you're going after Hunter Biden for $2 to $5 million that you claim that he got for whatever he did, I want to know why there's not an investigation into Kushner for getting $2 billion from the Saudi Arabia.
Steve Mnuchin, when he was Treasury Secretary, and Jared Kushner, whose father had just about a year before just been released from jail for fraud.
In fact, what's my man that's running for president? He was the one that sent his daddy to jail.
Christy. Yeah. So I mean, this is tick for tack. It's at a time when they ought to be focused on getting a budget so that the country doesn't shut down. But I'm also concerned about why the housing authority didn't pay its water bill.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, you know.
Yeah, that is very interesting.
I mean, you know, and I'm even more concerned about the reason they gave, because they were uncertain about its accuracy. Now, wow. Here's a city agency. I mean, you know, it's not a city agency. It's a private organization. But every member of the housing authority is appointed by the mayor, right? So it's controlled by the city. And it doesn't pay its own bills. And yet when a taxpayer goes in, a consumer goes in and says, I think the bill is inaccurate. You got to hire an expert. You got to hire an engineer. You got to hire a plumber. You got to hire all these people to try to prove that it's not, that their bill is not accurate. But the housing authority apparently can go for years without paying and accumulate a $7 million bill or more and just not pay a dime, and nobody says anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
Almost
mm-hmm.
like what happens with the hospital and hospitals and universities in Baltimore City, who for years have paid only a fraction of what they should be paying in real property taxes under agreements. Again, the one that I know about, according to the banner, was made initially by Stephanie Rollins Blake and extended again in 2016 by Stephanie Rollins Blake, and will continue now for 10 years, ending in 2026. I mean, what could the city do with that extra $100 million or so that they should be collecting in real property taxes from these organizations? And that's just the tip of the iceberg. But those are just a few of the things that concern me.
Final words, Tehma.
Thank you for joining us today. I've always find it to be a good conversation on the various topics. I'm Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney based out of Baltimore City. If you need to contact me for my services or contact me to follow up on any of the opportunities that I presented on the air regarding the health fair or the college fair, I can be reached at 667-334-7242. Once again, that's 667-334-7242.
Robert, the Dean.
Enjoy your weekend. 410-547-8820 is my number, and you have a matter involving a contract with the city, the state, or the federal government. Stay well.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. If you need our services, the number is 410-669-1738. And again, the viewing for Mona Lisa Marine will be on and services on Monday, Wake at 10, service at 11 in Park Lane Baptist Church, 3606 Mohawk Avenue. And for Miss Celestine Knight, the viewing is on Wednesday, September 20, 4 to 7 at Park Lane Baptist Church, 3606 Mohawk Avenue. But the services are going to be Thursday at Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, 10 o'clock wake, 10:30 funeral, 4016 Park Heights Avenue. And don't forget tomorrow at Gillis Memorial, 4016 Park Heights Avenue will be the Entrepreneur Day. I will be there doing a seminar on getting your affairs in order. It's from 11 to 3. Lunch is also being given at that time. And if you don't know how to register, just come and register once you get there. Okay? Every week from 10 to 12. And we want to thank our engineer Black for hanging in there with us. And every week on Friday from 10 to 12 here on WOLB 1010 on your dial. It's the Frank M. Conaway Sr. at our show with co-host Attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton Z. Douglas. And as I always say, take your head with your ear, put it to the ground, listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be it. Bye.
Smart, he's got more sense than many. His patience long.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB.